and it begins to destroy their marriage.
And he adores his daughter.
Mm-hmm.
Now comes the bombs are coming. Things are very bad, but they insist on going to buy something at the big department store. And something unfortunately happens.
Yeah, and that's really when Leo figures out that all of his choices have led him to the worst place he could possibly be.
Yeah.
So, and that's
what. But Amelia, the woman whom he had been told to seduce for the information, never got over him.
No, and she is a piece of work. I mean, with Amelia, I really tried to create one of those bad guys you'd love to hate, and she was incredibly selfish and really also ruthless in her own way, and she decided that what she really wanted was Leo, so she sort of waited in the wings, and when she saw a potential opening, she went for him.
You've really written two books in one here, because it's everything up to that moment, and then the second book is New York and Maddie being treated like, you know, Shirley Temple movie, The Little Orphan.
And you know, it's there was some talk of whether I should end the book right when Maddie goes to New York. But I felt like that left the story so incomplete, and it didn't give Leo any chance to redeem himself.
Yeah.
And also, the second book was always planned, and that would gradually become more of Maddie's story than Leo's story. So I felt like I really wanted to set the groundwork for that and try and, once again, explore the unintended consequences of Leo's decision to send Maddie away.
And Maddie in New York is going to a Catholic school because that's what everybody thinks the family is.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I have here in front the second book. Is that the sequel to this?
Yes, it is. It's very much a standalone sequel. But if you're already familiar with the characters, I think it helps you enjoy the book. And it's Leo is eventually recruited to work as a spy by the Allies as his way of earning his American citizenship, which actually happened quite a bit before World War One, and so it's about his story as a spy, but also Maddie's growing up when she finally discovers some of the silent lies that her father has let her live under.
Yeah. How did you start to become a writer? Did you go to a workshop or?
You know, I've just always been a writer. I wrote my first short story when I was 6 years old. I worked on the school newspaper. I wrote letters, and I only recently started getting paid for it, which was very nice.
How'd you get an agent?
That's kind of an interesting story. I try to do everything backwards. And the book was originally published by an independent press, very successful, been around for like 15 years, did mostly nonfiction, but some historical fiction. And then they went belly up within the first year, which was very inconvenient. But the distributor, which is the entity that for all academic presses and independent presses actually does the sales and storehouses the book, said that the book was selling pretty well and they'd be happy to keep selling it for me if I could get the rights back, which I was able to do. So I was in this really odd position of having my book in print after my publisher had gone out of business.
Yeah.
But it did just kept like the little engine that could, chugging along. Yeah. And at one point, there was an independent bookstore outside Charleston. Charleston, South Carolina, yep. And a friend of a friend had walked in and ordered 10 copies for her book club.
Yeah.
And the owner thought that was intriguing and read it, loved it. And so he and his staff started just hand-selling it, recommending it to people. And
Word of mouth,
that's right. And then lo and behold, this is a total Cinderella story. I still can't believe it happened. The marketing director for HarperCollins came in to the store. He was there with his family on vacation. And this gentleman put my book in his hands and said, "This is an excellent book. Why did you guys not publish it?" So he went back to New York, the HarperCollins person, and he wasn't about to waste his time reading this, so he sent it to a friend of his who was an agent. She loved it and called me up right away and said, "I don't know if we're going to get it to Harper, but I love this book. I'd like to be your agent. So that was
it. Who was that?
Helen Zimmerman. Mm-hmm. And she had worked with Random House. And then she'd owned a bookstore for a while. So she really knew every single end of the trade. And she's been marvelous.
Oh, that's such a wonderful story.
Yeah, it's really incredible. In fact, Publishers Weekly did a little profile on me, and they talked about it as the little engine that could, you know, just never get up.
When they bought it, did they want you to edit anything or change it?
The first book they did, in the first version, I had gone much more in depth into Leo's background and really his childhood, which I thought was important so you could understand why he made the decisions that he made later. But I think my editor felt that the book just started too slowly and asked me to kind of chop that out and weave his backstory into other parts of the book, which I think I did pretty successfully.
Yeah, you don't miss it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I have to say that. Let's talk about Emily back in New York. It won't spoil anything if I say she had the ticket to the last ship to leave Shanghai. Mm-hmm. And she says to our friend Leo, just shortly after his wife's died, come with me, marry me, and I'll take care, and Maddie can come with us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's kind of an offer too good to refuse, don't you think?
Yeah.
You know, because Leo's big concern at that point is to try to get his daughter out of Shanghai because the bombs are raining down.
Yeah. Little did he know it was going to be Mommy Dearest.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, exactly. And, you know, there again, some of my readers have said, I just can't believe that Leo would do that. But, you know, this was a time when...
Desperate times.
Yeah, and, you know, it was early, but in 1937, there were thousands of Spanish children sent out of Spain. Yeah. And then, of course, with World War II, you know, kinder transport and English people sending their kids to Australia to stay with strangers.
And Americans leaving Paris, as an great aunt and uncle did. Last ship that left... Portugal.
Yeah. So it really was. It was early, but it was that the beginning of that kind of desperate trend. And so he knows that he doesn't love Amelia and never will. But he figures that, and he doesn't know what a really wicked creature she is.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, as far as he is concerned, he was the one who had mistreated her.
Yeah.
And the fact that she would now do this for him, he was very grateful.
Yeah. And there's the lovely Mrs. O'Connor.
Yeah, that's, you know, so I had to sort of get my side of the family in there. My dad was Irish, and so I grew up with a bunch of Irish relatives. And in fact, one of the biggest compliments I got from the book was from my uncle, who said, my God, you nailed her accent completely. Just, we grew up on the Upper West Side. It was exactly like that. And so that was nice. I was able to pull that off.
And where was your mother from?
My mother was from Georgia.
Georgia.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So it was kind of the same ancestry as Scarlett O'Hara. I had, you know, this Irish immigrant dad and a Southern aristocratic mother.
And that you're writing about a poor Budapest Jew.
Right. Well, actually, I'd been interested in all things Hungarian for a while. My mom actually went back to school when she was 30. She already had four kids. Yeah. And she was thinking she would go be a nurse, but she started at junior college, and it turned out she was pretty smart. So she ended up going all the way through, and she got her PhD in history the week that I graduated from high school.
Mm-hmm.
So at some point, she was specializing in Hungarian history. I'm sure it had nothing to do with the fact that the Hungarian professor was very cute. But she asked me to help her with her research, because back then, you know, you had to actually go get the books and stuff.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So it just kind of became a little family joke that, you know, we just loved Hungary and all things Hungarian. Yeah. So actually, when I met my husband, and it was pretty much love at first sight for the two of us, and I asked him, so where's your family from? And he said, well, Hungary. It was like a sign from God.
Bingo. Yeah. Oh. Did you meet at law school?
Yes, we did. Yes, we did.
Yeah. But he's practicing law.
Mm-hmm. Yes, he's always enjoyed practicing law, and I lasted about 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just
Did you didn't enjoy it then?
No, and you know, I started out as a big firm litigator, and really at that point, the clients were paying the lawyers so much money, the first thing they want to do is settle. So I never really got into a courtroom, and I had decided to be a lawyer so that I could get into a courtroom and be a storyteller, essentially, which is what I am. And one, you know, it was the oral story, and you tell the witnesses, tell the jury your story, and you try to convince them. But that, I'd gone into the wrong field. I think if maybe I'd started in another aspect of the law, I would have been less disenchanted.
Well, all I can say is, as a lawyer or a storyteller, you convinced me.
Oh, thanks.
Really, as you can tell, I read it thoroughly and enjoyed it, and I look forward to the sequel here.
Yeah, that will be coming out in April. It's called A Heart of Deception, and it goes on to really describe the ways in which Leo's lies affected his daughter's life and, you know, what he has to do to try to get himself to America.
Yeah. And I'm sorry about Martha, but we use autograph my book.
Absolutely, with pleasure.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson. And you can link in to Claremont Graduate University Library that has digitized about 700 of the shows. Or you can link into YouTube. But better, go to your library. Start to read. There are some great new books, including Andrew Weiner's new book, The Marriage Artist. What is The Marriage Artist? He's the one who writes ketubas, which is a marriage contract, and how it plays into the art world of New York, as well as to trying to find out the mystery of why his wife and his artist friend jumped out of a building and killed themselves. Ugly things in their life that played back and caused it. And support your library, because libraries still are our greatest font of information and truly entertainment. What did the library mean to you growing up,
ML? Oh my gosh, it was quite literally my home away from home. I grew up in a very small town, and there was no movie theater, no McDonald's, no skating rink, nowhere to hang out, but I was always at the library. Yeah. And even to this day, you know, there's some information when you do historical research on the net, but I find it very shallow, so I'm always relying on the library. I love librarians.
Nothing like holding that book.
Right.
And I'm glad you said, because librarians are the greatest heroines of America. They are the ones who are helping people learn to read and read better. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.